In 1944 stortte de Amerikaan Claude Murray neer in het IJsselmeer. Murray kwam op 22-jarige leeftijd als vrijwillig piloot naar Europa. Vanuit Londen werd hij ingezet om met een Lockheed vliegtuigje vijandelijke doelen te fotograferen. In oktober 1944 ging het fout. Murray werd boven Arnhem door het Duits afweergeschut geraakt, waardoor een van zijn twee motoren uitviel. Toch vloog hij verder in de hoop Engeland te bereiken. Boven het IJsselmeer sprong hij eruit, nog voordat zijn vliegtuig in brand vloog. Na 13 uur met zijn rubberboot in het water rondgedobberd te hebben, belandde hij uitgeput op Pampers. De volgende ochtend ontdekte hij dat Pampers onbewoond was en besloot hij naar de kust te roeien. Halverwege kwam hij twee muie vissers tegen die begrepen dat Murray geholpen moest worden. Ze verstopten de Amerikaan in het riet en haalden meneer Roosendaal erbij. Roosendaal, zo wisten ze, zat bij de ondergrondse. Murray is tot de komst van de Canadezen in Muiden gebleven. Een tijd op de boerderij van Rechtuit aan de Korte Muidenweg en een tijd bij de familie Roosendaal en op nog wat andere plaatsen. Murray had via de ondergrondse een persoonsbewijs gekregen op naam van Jan Smit en ging als doofstomme boerenknecht, die ook nog niet helemaal goed bij zijn hoofd was, door het leven. Op 5 mei trok hij zijn pilotenuniform weer aan, ging de straat op en begon tot stomme verbazing van menig een te praten. Enige dagen later vertrok hij uit Muiden met de Canadese bevrijders. Voor het bevrijdingsfeest was Murray weer terug in Muiden, waar hij onder meer een bezoek bracht aan Pampers.
Dry grass. Now we have sheep.
So sheep, yeah.
Yeah. They are not 5 years.
Op Pampers was hij in de tijd zijn Sippo aansteker verloren. Van de stichting kreeg hij een nieuwe, met inscriptie.
1945 Pampers, 1995. And do you know something? No man has ever paid to have a Zippo lighter repaired.
This is my wife.
Hi, Bianca.
Ook kon hij kennis maken met de nieuwste aanwinst van Pampers, Baby Roos.
I want you guys to know that I'm going to present you with this book here, and your picture is on page 54. You don't know this, but I took a story that was in one of the local newspapers here.
Yes.
And I had a lady at a college in Phoenix, Arizona, translated it for me, this story here. And with your permission,
yes.
I have your picture on page 54.
Oh, yes. You have our permission. Yes.
And you probably will remember the story. It was by this
Impola.
Person.
The board, sir. Yep. Know the feeling.
Zal ik je voor losgooien, Nick?
Yes.
Of zal ik deze nemen?
Nee. Schoonvader en twee zwagers, twee broers. Die zijn wat burgers.
And then you came here, you went on a mission to fly over Germany and to make photographs of military things there.
Yes.
And you were shut down over Arnhem.
Yes. I think that's where it was, No, I'm not certain.
But you wanted to reach England.
Yes, I had hoped to go back. My airplane had two engines, one of them was shot out. And I had hoped to, and the airplane flies very well on one engine. However, the one that was shot out began to burn and fire in the airplane. So you must, when you have fire in an airplane, you've got to get out. So the airplane turned over and I came down in my parachute into this water. I inflated the rubber boat and got in it. And that rubber boat is supposed to have some paddles and something to make a sail with, but none of that stuff was in it. So all I could do was sit in the rubber boat.
And drift on the float.
And drift. And in the middle of the night, I floated into Pampas. I didn't know what it was, but it was land. The first Dutch land that I found. I was very happy. The next morning, I could see the outline of Muiden, so I knew there was a town there. So I got back in the boat and started to go to shore. I found some pieces of wood that I could paddle with, and I'm paddling to shore, and here come these three Dutch boys out fishing, and they took me in their boat, went to shore. We hid behind the dike. One of the boys went into the village and brought his father back. His father took a look at me. He went back to the village and brought back Mr. Rosendahl.
Which is the father of Mr. Siem Rosendahl.
Mr. Siem Rosendahl, that's correct. So within 1 hour of the time that I came on shore, I was with the Dutch resistance, with the Rosendahl resistance group.
And they housed you on different places. You went to different farmhouses, but you ended up spending most of the time with the family Rosendahl.
Yes. However, I must say that I did spend about 5 months at a boerderij, vlak by Muiden, on Kort Maardenweg. The boer was Gijs Rekdout, and I was in his house, between his house and Rosendahl's house, all that winter, back and forth.
And then it was May the 5th, and again my story says that you dressed in your uniform,
yes,
and went out on the streets, which,
yes,
was very dangerous.
Well, not 5th of May, it wasn't dangerous. I mean, well, it might have been a little bit dangerous because you did not know what the Germans were going to do. However, they had been ordered to lay their weapons down. And the 1st Canadian Army, who liberated the Muiden area, of course, came in to gather up those German soldiers, you might say. And so, yeah, it was a little bit dangerous because you didn't know who might take a shot at you. But it was so exciting to be free and to be able to go out in the street.
And to finally speak.
Yes, yes, because I had not been on the street at all. I was not, I was really, you might say, in hiding, because we could not take a chance on anyone knowing that I was there at the Rosendahl house.
And when did you finally get back home? When was that?
About a month, I think it was about, let's see, 5th of May, probably about the middle of June. It took that long. I went back to my base in England, and it took a little bit of time to go through all of the procedure to get orders to get on a boat, ship, and go back home.
And your family in the meantime, were you married at that time?
No.
But your parents or other relatives, did they know where you were?
No. Nobody knew where I was except British intelligence.
They knew. So
they
the,
knew.
The
yes.
underground?
Because the underground, when I first came to Muiden, it was necessary that they confirm my identity. They wanted to know who I was because they didn't know. I could have been a German spy. And so I gave them a little bit of information. Well, you know, according to the Geneva Convention, you're only required to give your name, your rank, and your serial number. But they, in addition to that, they said, we want to know the name of your flight surgeon, that is the doctor back at my Air Force group. So I said to myself, if I'm going to get them to trust me, I've got to trust them. So I told them. So then they got in touch with the British, and the British were able to go back to my base and say, who is this guy with this number? Was he where he said he was that day? And they said yes. So then, okay, Rosendahl and Don Sven and the underground officials said, okay, he's okay.
And that's a long time ago. That's 50 years ago.
50 years ago, yes.
And have you been back to Holland and to Muiden since then?
7 times.
So you have a special place in your heart?
Oh, yes, absolutely. My wife and I have more friends in Holland than we have in the United States, believe me. That's the truth.
And at the Liberation Day, we heard that a lot of Dutch girls went to kiss the liberators, the American and the Canadian soldiers. Were you ever kissed on that day?
In 1945? I cannot honestly say that I was. I'm sure I probably was, but I don't remember anybody in particular.
Then I will kiss for all the Dutch girls of those years.
Okay, do that. Oh, thank you so much.
Heel aardig. Nou, dat is een andere vrouw.